Hey, thought I'd go through a little bit of Cold Rain and Snow. It's not a very hard song, but it's a good one to learn a little bit about some theory. Also, just one that's fun to play. So I'll start off with going through some of Jerry's parts, and then focus on some of the stuff that Weir does. The song really kind of went through an evolution. In a sense, the versions in the 60s and the 80s and the 90s were very similar, with what happened in the 70s being very different. And I'm going to focus more on the 70s stuff, because I think it's more interesting, especially when it comes to Weir's parts. So let's just go through some of the basics. The way I think it helps to think about this song is, as we'll see, think about the introduction as basically built around the E minor pentatonic scale. And then when we get to the verses and the chorus, kind of think about that as built around the E mixolydian scale, both for the soloing that Jerry does, but also as a way of making sense of the chords that Bobby uses. All right, so go through some of Jerry's parts, and then we'll just look at what the basic progression of the song is, and then start overlaying some of the interesting stuff that Bobby does. Now, in the early days, Garcia would just kind of often slide his way into, starting on the E, slide his way up to the D note. So we've got places in the, say, late 60s where he was doing even something like this. Just using, as I said, the notes of the E minor pentatonic, the E, G, A, then we got our D, G, back down to E, E here, our B. Now, as the song went later into the 70s and then into the 80s, Garcia started adding some extra riffs to that. So one of the things that he would do sometimes be walk up from that E all the way up to the D via the G, G sharp, and the A to get to the D. Different stuff that you can do. You can work off of the A and the D up at the 5th fret, as he often does, or you can just do it on the open strings. When it comes to the transition over the D, sorry, over the E, you can slide it up to the 7th fret, or you can just get the E chord and work off those notes, and varying whether you're doing this sort of walk down using the intermediate notes in the E minor pentatonic, the D sharp, and also the B flat. Alright, now let's just go through some of the basic progression of the song. So we've got our opening riff. Think about that opening riff as essentially working off of the D. So think about the song as working off of the D chord. forth between the D and the E. Alright, so let's start talking about Weir's parts. In the introduction, let's look on the 90s or 80s versions, where he began to make heavier and heavier use of distortion. In the introduction, while Garcia is going through the licks that we had started with, Weir is going to do something pretty simple, and he's going to pretty much use this throughout the song. So this is one of the reasons why I find the 70s versions much more interesting, because Weir is doing something, he's doing a lot of stuff, whereas in the 60s, in the 80s, because of the organ that first Pigpen and then Brent were playing, and Vince, a lot of the licks and stuff that Weir would use to fill in the spaces and give the song some interesting little riffs and textures were picked up by the keyboards. So that left Weir, especially in this song, without a whole lot to do. So one thing that he would do is take your D chord, just get that bar shape, and then think about adding on the two notes that would essentially turn it into, if you wanted, kind of a version of a G chord. Essentially, you're taking your D bar shape, instead of taking that F sharp, add the G, and then get the B in there as well. So that little shape, think of it as the A minor 7th shape. So often what Weir would do in the beginning would be something very similar, simple, and he'd do this throughout the song. And when he would use the tremolo, often he would offer this, what I'm playing is a sort of E power chord or E5. He would bring in the tremolo. So as we get ready to think about what it is that Weir's doing, and we try to think about what notes are going to be available to him when he's doing his various riffs, think about what we've got. We've got a song that's got two chords, two major chords, D and E. It's unusual to find two major chords that are a whole step apart, D and an E, major chords. If you think about rock music, blues-based music, that's often built around a 1-4-5. If we think of the D and the E as the 4 and the 5, what would be the 1? Well, the answer would be A. So in fact, if you think about, though A doesn't actually show up as a chord in the song, if you think about the song being based around A, then A would be our 1, 4 and 5, the D and the E, would make sense. Take it a step further. Think about the notes that are in the A major scale. A, B, C sharp, D, E, F sharp, G sharp, E. Then think about the notes that are in the two chords that we've been playing. The D, which has D, F sharp, and A, and the E, which has the E, the G sharp, and the B. In other words, the notes of the two chords we're playing, they fit right in there with the notes of the A major scale. A final twist on this, which will help when we get to Garcia's lead, is that just like we saw with the introduction, the E is going to be emphasized. We're going to be playing lots of soloing bits that make the E a prominent note. So in some sense, it's going to be a modification of an E scale. What modification of an E scale would give you all the notes that are in the actual A major? Well, the answer is E mixolydian. And the way to see that that's the case is, you ask yourself, if it's E mixolydian, mixolydian is 5 in the order of modes, Ionian, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, mixolydian. If it's 5, then what scale would have E as the 5th? One way to see that, to make it easier on yourself, is just on the 5th string, grab the E, and think about what the 1 would be. That is, make the E a 5, what would be the corresponding 1? A. There's your one, there's your five. There's always that shape. There's your four, there's your five. So E Mixolydian is going to be the one that's got the same notes as the A major. If you then use that as your framework, it'll open up a whole bunch of notes for us to use when we're looking at riffs that Weir does. So let's put that to work and see how it plays out. Okay, so here's some stuff that Weir does. In addition to what we saw from the introduction, just that basic bar shape. We've also got C sharp, D, E, use the A if you want. Here's another little lick that he likes to use. A, G sharp, E, high B. Another thing to do is E, then use that instead of the G sharp, use the A just as a suspension. Pull that off. So another riff, E, F sharp, G sharp, B, E. So there's a little thing that he likes to do, a series of pull-offs from that sort of D suspended, if you want to think of that that way, or the sort of G-ish form of a D. Sometimes we'll get a sequence just of hard emphasis on the E. Now, when it comes to Garcia's solo, again, it'll help to think of this as using the notes of the A major scale, but focusing on the E. That is what I've called E Mixolydian. When you do that, you can make life much easier on yourself. A lot of people who try to play this, when I look at the tabs online, they worry about the soloing being done over the changes. So when Weir's on the D chord, having essentially playing the notes of the D scale, and then when Weir moves to the E chord, having your notes over the E scale. And that's something that Garcia does, but you can make life much easier on yourself by just thinking about it as being in E Mixolydian throughout, because that's got all the notes of the D chord and the E chord. And that'll let you just essentially stay in one place and do some of the licks that are familiar from that song. So if you think about what the A major scale looks like up at the 9th fret. Right, so we'll start with A, A, B, C sharp, D, E, F sharp, G sharp, A, B, C sharp, D, E. All right, so I hope that was of some use. Take it easy.